I'm sure you have seen such defects on your prints, where we have very ugly sections at the top of holes or bulging in small areas. You can quite often find extreme horrors posted online. But what causes these defects and how can we fix them? Is it even possible? After multiple test prints and testing various settings, my answer is yes. So let's learn an essential lesson about the culprit behind these defects and how to get rid of them for good. First of all, a perfectly round hole on X and Y plane can be quite challenging to print because it can create steep overhangs. I say can because it depends on how the hole aligns with the layer height. For example, a 5mm hole positioned with just a 0.1mm offset can produce two completely different printing scenarios. When the hole size and its middle position from the bottom aligns with the layer height increments, for instance 4.2, 4.6, 5 or 5.2mm, the result is a slightly smaller printed hole, but with reduced overhangs. However, if this alignment is broken, parts of the outer wall may end up being printed in midair, something we definitely want to avoid if we value print quality. This approach works best for smaller holes, but as diameter increases, more and more of the upper walls become unsupported. The proper solution for this currently is only in CAD, by limiting the top angles of the holes. But don't worry, even with a standard round hole design, there are still ways to improve print quality results. If you don't want to bother with any of the problems that come with 3D printing, the best way is just to use today's video sponsor PCBWay services. Even I get lazy and want perfect parts with no effort, as sometimes 3D printing can be really annoying. So if you feel the same way, check the link in the video description and get your parts made the easy way with so many options, like even 3D printing from metal. Going back to the topic, I tested a lot of different designs, ranging from U-shape to very round edges, but the one that performed quite well without deviating much from the original hole design was the one with the limited overhangs combined with small rounding and the chamfer on top. With this design, I tested so many different slicer settings, but only one fixed the defects. It was setting printing speeds of all walls to crawling 50mm per second. But that is not the solution most of us could accept. You see, back in the day we were printing even at lower speeds, as the main limiting factor was crappy extruders and low flow hotends. Nowadays, modern printers have greatly improved extruders and much longer hotends that allow for pushing printing speeds so much higher. The problem is that the higher printing speeds and longer hotends create higher back pressure when extruding the filament. That is why most modern printers use the pressure advance algorithm with smoothing to prevent over-extruding when printer has to slow down from high speeds or under-extrude when accelerating from low speeds. Also, different slicers can treat those slowdown and acceleration sections differently, but neither Bamboo Studio nor Orca Slicer is showing the actual printing speeds with the wall acceleration accounted for. Only the Prusa Slicer has this extremely important view setting, which reveals how complex printing speeds truly are. And my use speeds were not even that high compared to what you can see in the default printing profiles. The higher the speed difference, the more of this view turns into a complete chaotic storm of speed changes. But all of this shouldn't matter too much if we have a perfect pressure advance control, right? I spent a lot of time testing all kinds of settings with no improvements just to realize that there is a problem. When I was testing H2 series printers, the Bamboo Studio gave lower than needed values with manually triggered auto pressure advance calibration. Meanwhile, triggering this auto calibration before the print resulted in the best looking prints with very minimal defects. From all my testing, no setting provided better results than just having a spot on pressure advance value. Trying to achieve the same good results with a manual calibration in Bamboo Studio is possible, but it requires capping the max flow rate to the flow rate speed you will be printing the outer walls. This makes it hard to understand what is the point of the printing profiles then, but I digress. I like Orca Slicer's implementation so much better because the manual pressure advance calibration uses our actual printing profiles when testing. But again, if you thought you would be with just good enough pressure advance value, you're wrong. This is the main thing that I learned when trying to eliminate those defects near the top of the holes. Just try to imagine for a second. We have a filament that the extruder forces into a hot end, and on the over end we're trying to get a consistent line of only 0.4 mm from a molten plastic. It is quite hard to do that perfectly on its own, but we also have a variety of speeds that change in a rapid succession. The further we are from the ideal pressure advance value, the more we fall out of this fast-paced rhythm. So to get the exact needed value, I would say don't bother with PA tower or PA pattern manual calibration methods, as at least from my testing, it is very hard to tell the exact value to use. I got the best results using the line method. Just make sure you're using way smaller increments of 0.001. Anything higher is not accurate enough if you actually care about good looking prints. The only issue is that this pressure advance value can be affected by multiple variables like filament temperature, printing speeds, filament moisture level, filament diameter consistency, and many more. The moisture absorbed by the filament alone can make a huge difference. When it vaporizes inside the hotend, increase much higher pressure. As a result, your calibrated pressure advance value will vary depending on the filament's dryness. Materials like PETG or nylon, which absorb more water, are affected far more than something like PLA. The key takeaway is that pressure advance value plays a much bigger role than most people realize. A good enough value isn't sufficient with modern printers if you want great looking prints. Designers should also understand that perfectly round holes on X and Y planes aren't ideal for 3D printing, and overhang angles should be limited to avoid printing in midair. However, even with a well-designed model, an imprecise pressure advance value can ruin print quality. The longer the hotend, the higher the accelerations, and the greater the speed variations, the more critical it is become to have this value perfectly tuned. So if you truly value print quality, first of all, stop going crazy with printing speeds. All hotends heat filaments less, the faster we print. This not only worsens the biggest weakness of 3D printing, the lay adhesion, but also introduces more deviation from a calibrated pressure advance value in different printing scenarios. If your slicer allows, enable settings that make printing speeds more consistent. Plus, the lower the difference between the minimum and the maximum printing speeds, the easier it is to control those transitions from changing speeds. I'm sure you have experienced printing those calibration lines and seeing no line that is actually consistent. And finally, don't forget that the dry filament will give different values compared to a moist one. So either utilize automatic PA calibrations if they are reliable on your printer, or always keep your filament in a low humidity environment. Hopefully this video was useful and informative. If it was, make sure to leave a like and share the video with others who may have such defects or think this value is not that important. Huge thanks to everyone who supports my work on YouTube and Patreon. Well, that's all from me, and I'll see you next time.